My name is Pastor Marlon Curtin. This is the Rockaway Cathedral. Welcome to our Sunday service. Welcome to our Sunday service. If you like what you see here, please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Our foundational scripture is Matthew 7, verses 24 and 25. Matthew 7, verses 24 and 25. We at the Rockaway Cathedral say, we're building God's kingdom in you. Be blessed.
It's January
22nd, 2023. Welcome to online worship at the Rockaway Cathedral. We are so glad that you have chosen to be with us this morning. Whether you're just having a look or seeking a place to worship, we are delighted to have you here. And though we may not be able to meet together physically, that is not going to stop us from rallying together spiritually. Join us online for a time of worship and a message from Pastor Marlon Curtin.
Join us in experiencing the joy of singing to the Lord with the gospel duo, Melody and Harmony.
Thank you.
Bible study is back, starting on January 10th. Join us weekly on Tuesdays for the series Holiness 2.0. Join us every Tuesday from 7:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. on Zoom, meeting ID 960-2462-6792 and password 271-927.
Thank you for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Lord, we lift up families. We lift up families. We pray, Lord, for love in the family. Fathers, loving mothers. Mothers, loving fathers. Parents, loving children. Children, loving, respecting their parents. Lord, let the family be based on love. Let the family be based on love. Let everybody sacrifice for everybody else. Let people, let family members look out for each other. Do their best for each other. Forgive each other. Help each other and support each other. I pray, Lord, for families. Families. Families in the New York area. Families in the body of Christ. Families in the New York area. Families in the body of Christ. Let families support each other. Let families love each other. Let families not be in competition with each other. And let families want the best for each other. And let them pray to you. Let them cry out to you. Let them confide in you to help them. To help them, to help each individual family member be dedicated and committed to the other family members. Let them go to you, Lord. Let them go to you, God. Let them look to you, Lord, to show them so that they can ask from you how I could be a better husband, how I could be a better wife, how we could be better parents, and how I could be a blessing to my family. Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's scripture of the day is taken from Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, in the King James Version. Come now, and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. The Rockaway Cathedral is a nonprofit organization that is seeking to win souls for the Lord in the Far Rockaway community. We especially want to make a difference in the lives of those who are often disenfranchised. However, we need your support to get there. Your act of kindness can be a lifesaver for someone. Remember, richness is not necessary, but willingness is. Please visit our website at www.therockawaycathedral.com. Click on the blue Donate tab at the bottom of the page, then click Make a Donation. We are also asking that you continue to support us by viewing our service once a week. We're now on Cash App. You can send your donations to hashtag Rockaway Cathedral. We thank you for your partnership and continued support.
Good morning, God bless you. Welcome to the Rockaway Cathedral. So today is not part of our series, The Sabbath Rest. This week and next week will not be part of our series called The Sabbath Rest. It's going to be about, today's message is called Mirror, Mirror. It's about judgment. So, you know, it's very easy to kind of walk and live in a life of judgment. But the word says that there is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who live according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh. So there's a place in God where you could live without judgment, without self-judgment, and without condemnation, without self-judgment, without self-condemnation. We're going to touch on that today. I'm bringing to you and talking about a story that we all heard about and learned about when we were kids, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. So today's message is called Mirror, Mirror. Not part of any series, but today's message is called Mirror, Mirror. Be blessed.
Join us as we welcome the gospel duo, Melody and Harmony.
Speak to my heart, Holy Spirit, give me the words that will bring you life, words on the wings of a morning, the dark night will fade away if you speak to my heart. Speak to my heart, Holy Spirit. Message of love to encourage me, lifting my heart from the snare, how you love me and care for me. Speak to my heart, oh speak to my heart, Holy Spirit, give me the words that will bring you life. Words on the wings of a morning, my dark nights will fade away if you speak to my heart. Speak to my heart, Holy Spirit, message of love to encourage me, lifting my heart from the snare, how you love care for me, speak to my heart. Your word abide. Speak to my heart, Lord, and give me your holy word. Oh, if I can't hear from you, oh, then I'll know what to do. I won't go alone. Said I'll never go on my own. Oh, just let your spirit guide. Oh, and let your word abide. Oh, speak to my heart, Lord, and give me your holy word. Oh, if I can hear from you, oh, then I'll know what to do. I won't go alone. Said I'll never go on my own. Oh, just let your spirit guide. Oh, and let your word abide. Oh, speak to my heart, Lord, and give me your holy word. Oh, if I can hear from you, oh, then I'll know, then I'll know, then I'll know what to do. I won't go alone. I'll never go on my own. Oh, just let your spirit guide. Oh, and let your word abide. Oh, speak to my heart, Lord, and give me your holy word. If I can't hear from you, oh, then I'll know what to do. I won't go alone. Your spirit guide, oh, and let your word abide. Speak to my heart, Lord, and give me your holy word. If I can't hear from you, oh, then I'll know what to do. Then I'll know what to do. I won't go alone. I'll never go on my own. Just let your spirit guide, and let your word abide.
Good morning, good morning. God bless you. Welcome to the Rockaway Cathedral. My name is Pastor Mon. Today's message is called Mirror, Mirror. Today's message is called Mirror, Mirror. It's not part of any particular series. I have two scriptures today. The first is Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. I'm going to be reading from the King James Bible. Please stand for the reading of God's word. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. Today's message is called Mirror, Mirror. Come, here beginneth the reading of God's holy word. Come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. So far the scripture. And next is 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, also from the King James Version. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. Here we get into the reading of God's holy word. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So far the scripture. Lord, let's just speak to your people today. Speak through your servant and bless your people today. In Jesus' name, amen. So, again, when we were kids, we all watched this movie called Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs is a full-length animated film by Disney Studios made in 1937. A full-length animated film made by Disney Studios in 1937. But it's based on a book called Snow White by the Brothers Grimm. Brothers Grimm are some German brothers who wrote this book in the 1800s. So Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, full-length animated film by Disney Studios in 1937, based on a book, Snow White by the Brothers Grimm. So Snow White is an orphan. Her parents died, so she's living with her stepmother, who happens to be Queen. Snow White's stepmother is Queen. Snow White's stepmother is a wicked queen. They call her the Wicked Queen. Bad queen. So instead of treating Snow White like a princess and have her live in a palace and live in that type of kingly environment, queenly environment, nope. She puts her to live with the servants. She makes her the lowest of the lowest servants. You know, just clean up. I don't want to see you. I don't want to see you around, because she's secretly jealous of Snow White's beauty. So every day she has a mirror. The mirror, of course, it's just, you know, it's a cartoon. So it's a magic mirror. And she says to the mirror, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest of them all?" Mirror, day after day, says, "You are my queen. You are my queen." So she goes every day, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest of them all? You are my queen." But one day, at some point, you know, Snow White's still toiling, still living the life of a servant, even though she's a princess. One day, the queen goes before the mirror, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest of them all?" It's, mirror says, "Snow White is the fairest of them all." Wow. All this time, I'm the fairest. I'm the most beautiful. Fairest means beautiful. I'm the most beautiful in the land. Now it's my stepdaughter, Snow White, so I got to get rid of her. So she decides, comes up with a plan. Okay, so I'm going to get rid of her. I'm going to kill her. I'm not going to do it myself. So she hires a huntsman. This person's called a huntsman. Says, "Hey, huntsman, take her out to the woods and kill her. Bring her, bring proof of her death to me." So the huntsman goes out, takes Snow White out in the woods. Snow White has no idea what's going on. Not a clue. So the huntsman goes out, you know, he's supposed to do the deed. Then he gets paid to do the deed, but he can't do it. He says, "Man, I can't kill this woman. She doesn't know anything about anything. She's just a little girl." So sends her on her way, says, "Look, good, just keep running, don't come back." So he takes a proof of death back to the queen. Queen is satisfied, thinks Snow White is dead. So Snow White doesn't know what's going on. She's running around in the woods. Magic forest, of course, they take her to a hut, a cabin. Cabin is kind of in disarray. So she cleans it up, cooks some food, falls asleep on the bed. The owners of the cabin are the seven dwarfs. The seven dwarfs come in. "Hey, what's going on? You know, who are you? How's this place so clean?" So she tells them the story. "I'm running away from my evil stepmother." So they take her in. They take her in. So, you know, so she lives with them. And everybody's cool. They're cool with her. She's cool with them. So I guess a while later, Queen says, "Oh, you know, thinking she's gotten rid of Snow White. Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest of them all?" It's still Snow White. And by the way, she's alive, living in the woods with the seven dwarfs. So she's enraged. "Oh my God, how could this be?" So she comes up with a plan to deal with Snow White. She comes up with a plan to deal with Snow White, because she cannot take this title away from her. "I have to be the fairest of them all." Snow White and the seven dwarfs. Snow White and the seven dwarfs. Go check out the movie. Let you take it, take your kids there. I'm sure there's different ways to see it, or read the book, Snow White by the Brothers Grimm. Book is a little bit different than the movie, but, you know, they're both, it's a good read. I haven't read it yet, and it's an excellent movie, which I've seen. So let's go through the scriptures again. Again, they're both one verse each. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. "Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." And 1 John 1:9, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Now, the Greek word for cleanse, means, because 1 John 1 talks about cleansing, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Old Testament's written in Hebrew, New Testament's written in Greek. The Greek word for cleanse means to cleanse, literally or figuratively. It also means to purge or to purify. It means to cleanse, literally or figuratively. Also means to purge or to purify. I have 3 points today. The first point is the mirror. Point one is the mirror. Now, in the book, The only thing about the book I'm going to talk about is in the book, the mirror always tells the truth. In the book, the mirror always tells the truth. But symbolically, the mirror is really about self-judgment. The mirror is really about self-judgment. So the queen is fixated. Is fixated on a certain aspect of her life. The queen is fixated on her appearance. Not only is she the leader of this realm, this land, as being queen, but she's also very concerned about her image in her kingdom, her image in the community, her image amongst the people in the palace. It's not enough for her to be in charge. It's not enough for her to be the unquestioned ruler of this kingdom, this land, this community. It's important for her also to have this appearance that she has to be the most beautiful one of them all, the most beautiful woman in the land. And so she's obsessed with this. She's obsessed with how she looks at herself. This section, this message in part is about self-judgment. So how many of us have that scale that we step on every day? Every day. That's measuring yourself, judging yourself. How many of you say, to your husband, do I look okay? How does this look? How many preachers say, ask their wives, honey, how was the message today? How was the service today? So we all have engaged in this thing of self-judgment. Everyone has a mirror. How I look today, put on the makeup a certain way. When you shave, you got to make sure that, you shave right, get everything out. Comb your hair, you got to make sure. A certain measure of self-judgment is okay. You want to comb your hair to make sure it's okay. You want to shave to make sure, see where you're shaving and make sure you don't cut yourself. And you get everything out. You need to look at the mirror to see if the button is missing, or if the clothes are too wrinkled, or if the dress needs to be ironed. So looking at the mirror, some form of self-judgment is healthy. Some form of self-judgment is necessary to live in a society like us, like ours. You have to judge yourself on some level. But what the queen did with her self-judgment was tied up in vanity and pride. It's not enough for her to be beautiful. Mirror, mirror on the wall, am I beautiful today? Yes, queen, you are beautiful. Mirror, mirror on the wall, is my outfit on the right way? Yes, queen, it's on the right way. Mirror, mirror on the wall, do I need to iron this outfit or is there a stain on it? No, queen. The mirror always tells the truth. No, there's no need. So having a form of self-judgment is healthy in a modern society. But her thing, she was tied up. Who's to say who's the most beautiful one in the country, in your company, in your church, on your block? Why is that important to you? Isn't it important to just be the best kept person? But then there's another side of judgment. Sometimes there are people who look at themselves and all they see is shame. They're ashamed about some of the things that have happened to them in life. It wasn't even their fault, but somebody did something to them and it caused them a great deal of shame and embarrassment. So some people are feeling guilty about the sin they committed, about the addiction they have, about their past life in terms of criminal activity. Guilt about not doing this. Guilt about doing this. Guilt about hurting that person. Shame that this person hurt me. Shame that you're put in a situation that you didn't ask for. So many of us, so there's two types of unhealthy self-judgment. One is a certain vanity. Not satisfied to be the best at what you, to be the best at what you do, but comparing yourself to others, making sure that you have to be that person. There's a certain vanity, but then there's the other side of the mirror, the mirror of shame and guilt and judgment. You know, and this is where many of us find ourselves. Some people caught up in vanity, some people caught up in guilt, and some people caught up in shame. But the mirror represents, the mirror in the story represents a form not of self-analysis. She didn't say, how was I dressed today? Is there a stain on it? But that's self-analysis. Self-analysis could lead to therapy. Self-analysis could lead to prayer. But guilt, shame, and vanity are not places that we want to be. Point two, glass house. Now, glass house is about judging others. So the queen was not only doing self-judgment, but she judged Snow White. You know, this person has got to go. She can't be better than me. She can't be more than me. And so glass house is about judging others. So some form of judging others is healthy. You know, the Bible talks about, you know, settling matters with your brother before you go to pray, about husband, in terms of husbands and wives, just generally speaking, don't let the sun go down on your anger. So sometimes healthy conversations, healthy confrontation is required in the body of Christ. Resolving problems among friends and family and even in the church is something that the Bible talks about over and over again. It's okay to resolve problems in your family. It's okay to resolve problems among your friends. It's okay to resolve problems in the church. It's part of a healthy life. You don't want to hold a whole bunch of grudge and anger in your heart toward this person you see every day. And companies have ways of resolving problems in the company. You go to this person, you go to the, human resources. There's ways to resolve problems in society. And of course, we have the courts, which are ways to resolve problems among people and companies that have issues with each other. Judging others, confronting others, as long as it's done with love in terms of the family and rationally in the courts, you don't want to be filing irrational, crazy lawsuits. As long as your personal relations are dealt with love, as long as your business and company relations are done with rationality, the Lord allows people to have to resolve disputes that arise among them. God's not stupid. God knows that people are going to have problems, and he authorizes you to resolve the problems in your family, friends, church, and even in the marketplace. But glass houses is a bit different. Glass houses is about judging people that you don't know, you never met. I mean, we live in a society where people, you see something in a newspaper, you see something on the internet, you see something in the public circle. Now, you're never going to meet that person. You're never going to run across this senator, this person who's president, this person who's running for president, this CEO, this football coach, this basketball coach, this actor, this actress. You're never going to run into these people. You know, but you read about them and you're like, you're always judging these people. You know, oh, this guy's an idiot. She needs to shut up. This guy needs to go home. This person needs to be fired. So, you know, if you live in a glass house, you shouldn't throw stones. If you are judging those people that you don't know, you better believe that there's some people who you know who are judging you. And God forbid, if you become a public figure, most people won't be. But if you become a public figure, God forbid somebody starts judging you because you do this, because you do that, blah, 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 blah. You know, I don't want to use the word political correctness. I don't want to use those words. But sometimes you have to give people the benefit of the doubt. Why are you always calling for somebody to be fired or to go to jail or to lose an economic opportunity because they make a mistake, because you don't like them, because they do this instead of that? I mean, let me give you an example. I mean, I'm a Obviously, a big sports fan. I like mostly New York teams, except for football. I mean, I like Knicks and the Mets, and I like the Yankees. I really admire the Brooklyn Nets. You know, I'm a New York sports fan, generally speaking, but when it comes to football, I like the Dallas Cowboys. So the Dallas Cowboys are my favorite team. So their coach is named Mike McCarthy. Mike McCarthy is the coach of the Dallas Cowboys. Mike McCarthy on his other team has a winning record. Mike McCarthy on his other team won a Super Bowl. Now he's with the Cowboys, and the Cowboy Nation desperately wants to win a Super Bowl. Haven't won a Super Bowl since the 90s. Going on 30 years now. So Mike McCarthy has a winning record with the Cowboys. Mike McCarthy takes his team to the playoffs just about every year, but sadly, the Cowboys have not won a Super Bowl. So there are people on these television shows. If Mike McCarthy doesn't win the Super Bowl this year, he should be fired. Now, you know, these people don't even know Mike McCarthy. But, you know, people that call these stations, you don't know anything about this person. You don't know who his wife is, who his kids are, where he's from. I don't even know where he's from. I don't even know how old he is. Of course I want the Cowboys to win. Of course, you know, somebody should be held accountable if they don't win. But that doesn't mean that this guy should be fired. But that's the kind of society we're getting into. People who are living in glass houses. People who are subject to judgment themselves, which is everybody, because everybody is on social media now, so people could judge you on social media. Everybody lives a life, so your neighbors, your friends could judge you for this because you do this, because you don't do that. Everybody is subject to some kind of judgment. And if you don't want to be judged, you probably should try to figure out a way not to judge other people. There is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you want to live in Christ Jesus, a life without condemnation, be a person who is not under condemnation because you have a relationship with God. Try to treat others, even if you don't know them, even if they're not in Christ Jesus. Don't live a life of judging other people. Don't live a life of judging other people. If there's somebody in your circle you need to deal with that person. Family, friends, colleagues, coworkers, deal with that person. But somebody walking down the street or somebody on public TV or television, it's okay to have an opinion, but, you know, stop calling for everybody to be thrown into the river. Can't live in that type of, can't. You who live in a glass house, I who live in a glass house, should be careful how we judge people that we don't even know and are not likely to meet in life. Point three, white as snow. God's forgiveness triumphs over guilt and shame. God's forgiveness triumphs over guilt and shame. So we know what happened. We know that the wicked queen goes out and comes up with the scheme of, if I can get Snow White to eat this apple, she'll be in a death sleep. She won't be dead, but she'll sleep forever. You know, no way she could wake up if she gets kissed by somebody that loves her. So she disguises herself, finds a way to get into the cabin of the seven dwarfs, gives her this apple. She eats the apple. She falls into a death sleep. Nobody could wake her up. Dwarves put her out into the woods. They're heartbroken. But people forgot that before she got to them, when she got kicked out of the house, she runs into a prince. At some point, she runs into a prince. They fall in love, but obviously because she's on the run, they can't do anything. So the prince sees her in the woods, sees her in a state of basically a comatose state, kisses her, she wakes up. And of course, you know, they live happily ever after. You know, the things that we've done to others and the things that others have done to us could really put us in a situation where we're living like zombies. We're barely awake because we're just racked with guilt. Every day you get up, you feel guilty about this thing that you did or these things that you did. Every day that you wake up, you feel shame for the thing that this person, this community, this organization or somebody did to you. Just ruins your life. And some people, you've ruined other people's life. And when you live in guilt and shame, it's like you're like Snow White. You're not dead. You're alive. But you're not really functioning. You just kind of sleepwalking through life. You know, you're doing this, you're doing that, but you know, there's no taste in your mouth. There's no joy. There's no pep in your step. You're doing things, but you're being dragged down by this guilt, or you're being pushed down by the shame. Being dragged down by this guilt, or pushed down by the shame. But the Lord gives us an out. The thing about Isaiah, the book of Isaiah is written by the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah is the book that's sort of like this army's marching. He's writing this at a time where Judah and Israel are separated. And Israel, which is the northern kingdom, is under threat by Assyria. Judah, and I believe by the time it's written, Israel had been invaded and destroyed, and the people deported back to Assyria. And later on in Isaiah's life, those same people attack and lay siege to Judah. So Isaiah is sort of like a guy, a prophet on a mountain, and he's writing these things because he has an opportunity to see armies moving, people being moved out, war. At the time he started his ministry, a good king, Uzziah, died unexpectedly at a young age. A king who was doing all these things, and all of a sudden, he's dead. So Isaiah is writing in a time of immense political upheaval in Judah, in Israel, and in communities all around. Just as soon as Assyria raises up and comes down, Babylon is raised up. So all of these things are going on when Isaiah is writing. But then he comes back. He comes back to you. To the people of God, to God's people, the chosen people. He says, look, if you repent, and he's talked about this early verses, if you repent, don't you know that God can make you your sins as white as snow? In the midst of all this war, this political upheaval, right? Isaiah is the vehicle for God to say, even to people in the midst of political upheaval, if you repent, I could make your sins as white as snow. And First John is a completely different situation. John being one of the 12 apostles, one of the disciples that became an apostle. All the other apostles were murdered, killed for the sake of the gospel. Happily so. John is the one that was not. It was history behind that, but he was the one who died, the only one that died of natural causes. So John, you could see John writing, and John is like the apostle of love. He's always talking about the love of God, the love of Christ. You know, if you could picture how the environment in which God, John is talking, so like a guy with a campfire surrounded by about 12 or 14 people, not a big crowd. John has a very intimate relationship of Jesus Christ. So as he's writing, as he's telling these stories, it's sort of like you're sitting by a campfire and you're listening to hear about the love of God, the goodness of God, the sovereignty of God. These are the things that John keeps talking about. 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, the book of John, and of course, Revelation. And even in the midst of that situation, it's the same theme. If you ask God for forgiveness of your sins, if you ask God if you go to Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, he will cleanse you, purify you, make you pure, right? Instead of being drowned in shame, stained with guilt, he could wash you as white as snow and make your life pure. So the mirror does not lie. You did do that to that person. Yeah, that was you. The mirror does not lie. Yes, that person did that to you. It's true, it happened. But the mirror, even though it's showing you these things, in many respects, the mirror is an instrument of self-judgment, of negative self-judgment. But what the word says in Isaiah, when armies are moving, what the word says in John, if you're just listening and trying to figure out and understand the love of God. Whatever your situation, whatever your environment, whether you're around a campfire, whether you're in the midst of political upheaval, there's always a mechanism, always an opportunity for you to go to God, directly for the forgiveness of your sins. And when you do, he will cleanse you and purify you. He will cleanse you and purify you. And though your sins be as scarlet, he could wash you as white as snow. That's it. You're here today, you've never accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. You've never accepted him as Lord and Savior of your life. If that's you, pray this prayer after me. Lord, forgive me my sins. I'm a sinner. I know you came for me. I know you lived for me. I know you died for me. And on the third day, you rose again from the dead. Today, I confess that you are Lord. And I believe in my heart that you rose from the dead. Therefore, today, I'm saved. My name is Marlon Curtin. This is the Rockaway Cathedral, building God's kingdom in you. Go in victory, go in peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father, we come to you with praise and thanksgiving. We praise and worship you for who you are. Thank you that through your sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, we now have a relationship with you. Because of your grace and mercy, we can now come boldly to your throne to ask for forgiveness of our sins. Father, remind us that once you forgive us, you wipe away the memory of our sins. Lord, we need to remember your grace and accept your forgiveness instead of reminding ourselves of what we've done wrong. Satan would like to have us feel hopeless and unworthy and keep us in a constant state of unworthiness. Lord, we desire to lead a life of holiness. We want to shun the things that are not pleasing to you. Teach us how to learn from your word the things that are displeasing to you and to be guided by them in our daily lives. Holy Spirit, touch our hearts when we sin and remind us to run to the throne to beg for forgiveness. Also, remind us that we are children of God and that nothing can separate us from him. Thank you, God, for your grace and mercy. We love you and desire to serve you all the days of our lives. We pray this prayer in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thanks for worshiping with us today. We pray that you were blessed by the word brought to us by Pastor Marlon. Go in God's grace until we meet again for Sunday service, Tuesdays for Bible study from 7:30 to 8:30 p.m., and be sure to check out our website for further information about our ministry. God bless you. And remember, you are dismissed from this service, but never dismissed from God's presence.